Hey everyone, welcome to the RLT podcast where we share some real life tools, tips, and tricks to help you not only discover, but also reach your ultimate goals. What's up everyone? Welcome to the 29th episode of the Real Life Tips podcast. We've really enjoyed making that intro. Leon, what did you think when I shared that with you?
Yeah, man, I never wanted that to stop, eh? I'm hoping that we've got the same effect on the crowd and everyone that just listened to that. But that was jamming, man. Really, really good job there. If you didn't notice and you're new to the show, that was a rock rendition of our normal jazzy type intro. So fantastic work. I'm actually going to load that up as my ringtone. I'm going to play that in the shower. It's an awesome intro, man.
I had so much fun actually composing, well, not composing, but adding to the existing intro that we had there. So if you haven't noticed, this entire episode is all about music, and we thought it best to spend some time to create a different version of our introduction here today to keep it interesting, to keep it special, and to personalize it a little bit, because myself and Leon, we've gone through our heavy metal rock phases and ages and stuff in the past as well in our younger years, and it's still something that I quite enjoy doing, playing around with some compositions, playing some guitar, adding in some drums and stuff like that. So really hope that you guys enjoyed that intro. So welcome back to a brand new, fresh episode of the Real Life Tips podcast. And I think this is going to be a very, very interesting one, a very good one. Leon, don't you want to do the introductions here?
Yeah, man. So this is, as I mentioned, this is something we've been wanting to do for a while. And talking about music, I think the reason this is, very close to myself and Manu's heart is this is something that we just grew up with. Made huge impact in our lives, specific genres of music, specific moods, specific artists, etc. And I think this is something that a lot of people, again, is going to relate to. And I'm pretty sure for all of you out there listening right now, there are some songs or some music genres that you listen to. Maybe there's some music that you listen to when you're quiet or when you're alone. Maybe there's some music that you listen to while you are working out. Maybe there's music that you listen to while you go out partying or clubbing with your mates or your friends, or you're at a barbecue or something like that. And it's something that is such a huge impact in the whole world on most people's lives. And it's interesting to actually look into it a little bit deeper and see what are the actual impacts that music make in our lives, and why is it that we're so drawn to it? I don't really think I know anyone that doesn't have some sort of liking towards a specific type of music or genre of music. And it's just something that, you know, when you're sad, you think about a song. When you're happy, you have a song going in your head. It's just something that is almost relatable to mood, to places, history that you shared with someone. There's always a song that brings it together.
Yeah, Leon, I think it's going to be a great episode today, and specifically looking at it from a few different angles. You know, I think, like you mentioned, we all have had some sort of experience with music in the past, or it might have taken us through some really, really tough and difficult times. It might remind us of some really good past experiences, but we're really going to look at it from some past experiences as well as some very interesting side notes of what does the science say? What does the research say behind it? Is there a specific reasoning for specific genres of music that has a specific impact on our lives and the things that we do and the way that we react to specific situations? And really, how can we use music to spur on personal growth? How can we actually use music to change our lives, to impact things, our moods in our lives, or the situations that we're setting in as well? We're also going to have a look at some misinterpreted or most misinterpreted genres out there. I think that's going to be quite interesting because there's a lot of opinions that people have about heavy metal music or classical music or jazz and those type of things as well. So we'll touch a little bit more on that as well. But what we can promise you is after today's episode, you will definitely have a better understanding as to what role does music really play in our lives and how can you use that to your own advantage. How can you use that to achieve optimal results in certain scenarios, whether it is, you know, trying to lighten your mood or trying to sit down and concentrate and focus on studying or whatever the case is. So some really, really interesting tips, I think, that's going to come out of today's episode, Leon.
Yeah, definitely. I think we can dive right in there because, you know, it's interesting that music is something that comes through your ears, but somehow it influences your feel and your mood and your heart. You know, if I take myself, for example, as we mentioned, it feels like episode, like 20 episodes back when I started my journey with training and fitness and so on. I can't really see myself going to the gym without some sort of music or podcast, any kind of audible thing happening in my ears, right? And the funny thing is, if I listen to podcasts, yes, it feels like I'm doing two good things at once then, right? I'm training my mind while I'm training my body. But there's just something that happens when you're doing cardio where you can't really listen to podcasts. You have to slap on some dance music or some pumping clubhouse music or something, you know, just to get the blood flowing, to build up extra reserve of energy that you weren't quite able to tap into without that nice pace and thump on the bass and the treble and the beat and so on. And that's not just me. I mean, I look around in the gym every morning. Well, I say every morning. we'll talk about that in another episode. But whenever I am there and I look around and I look at the people, everyone's got headsets on.
Yeah,
have you noticed that? Like every single person. The only person that doesn't have headsets on is the trainers walking around. I don't know what they do in the gym. They already look good. But they walking around, they're giving instructions. The other people all have headsets on. They've all got their heads nodding towards some beat or some music, and it gives them energy. So I think one of the big things that music really helps with that I've noticed is it's a huge source of untapped energy or reserve energy that you have, but it's almost like the music is the key of unlocking that extra energy. It's strange. Like I would be, I'll give you another example of where I noticed the energy factor for me is, if you're a South African, you'll know this very well, but every like once in 2 years or whatever, I take my family down to Cape Town, and that's a long trip. Mm-hmm. That's a 14, 15-hour trip, excluding stops next to the road, you know, bathroom stops and so on. And I promise you, at some stage in the car, I am the only woke person. And the only thing that helps then is to put on some old-school Robert Miles or some Dire Straits old-school rock and roll music, something that you've always thought about driving on a long open road with. You know what I mean? Like there's that type of music.
Yeah.
It could be like nice country music, or it could be very deep classical music, or something that just kind of lifts you off and takes you off into like the darkness or wherever. Like in South Africa, driving down to Cape Town, you've got this whole area, the Karoo, where you drive straight. You can literally just put your car straight and probably drive as fast as you want if you don't get caught. And during that time, there's just nothing better than blasting your favorite nostalgic music, eh? And
it kind of makes you feel like you're in a music video, doesn't it? Like,
yeah.
I don't know. That's the sort of experience that I have. I know exactly what kind of songs you're talking about, because it's always those type of songs. Like I've got two or three of them that I can pinpoint right now that I'm thinking of. That I always, you know, if I'm taking a long trip, even if it's just an hour drive or an hour and a half drive, I'll definitely add that onto that playlist, because it makes you feel like you're in a music video. It makes you feel that like everything's going to be okay and
nothing
life is
matters,
just good,
right?
And everything.
Yeah.
No, I think it is important, Leon. I think, like you said, you know, it has this massive power that, you know, it alters your mood entirely. It really, really can take you from a low of saying, I just woke up, I just got to the gym, maybe today isn't my day, I'm not feeling it. But you slap on a pair of headphones, you add on some great tunes onto your playlist, and then all of a sudden you feel so much better. It's like something happens in your body. All of a sudden the rhythm just, you know, kicks in and you're ready. And I know what you're talking about in terms of exercising specifically as well. If you have the correct type of music that really speaks to your soul and speaks to the energy levels inside you and really brings out the best in you, You can go for an extra 20 minutes, an extra 30 minutes, or go for another 100%. Extra.
You don't even realize the pain, yeah.
Yeah, go for an extra set and all of that. So it really, really does have a massive impact on that as well. I think one of the other things that's quite interesting with music that you also mentioned, you know, thinking about the long open road and the way that it just alters and helps you push through times that you might feel tired and stuff as well. I know that music has a massive, massive impact on the concentration that you have whilst doing work. So yeah, I've actually got some really cool playlists that I've built up over time that I've played around with some of the good tunes that I always have on my most popular playlists and stuff that I always listen to. But I've actually now created a dedicated playlist for listening to specific type of music when I'm concentrating heavily at work and things like that. That just really puts me into the zone. There's also a lot of studies that have been conducted and research that have been conducted around this as well, that it actually can help boost concentration levels. It can help boost the retainment of the knowledge that you have whilst listening to that music and while studying as well. So I think that is definitely something worth looking into as well. And I'd like to share some more insights around some studies when we get to the research portion of this. One of the other things though, Leon, that I do think is quite interesting as well is, have you ever listened to a specific song and you can instantly take yourself back to and put yourself in your shoes 15 or 20 years ago?
Yeah.
It's insane how powerful that is. It's like it uses all like a bunch of different senses and things happen inside your body. It's weird because I've listened or I've come across a specific song recently that I listened to when I was in primary school.
Mm.
Dude, and I still can remember like exactly. I was laying on my bed or staring at the ceiling. The song was playing on 5FM and it feels like I'm there. It's completely teleports you sort of back into that day and time and the feeling that you felt and everything. How powerful is that? Hey?
That happens all the time. So I'm very nostalgic when it comes to music, and I've got certain songs that when I hear them, and I don't think that's just me, I think that's probably everyone, they just, like you say, it teleports you to a specific date, place, time, smell, whatever it might be, and you can remember it so vividly. And I mean, I always say to my mates that I've got quite a long memory as to how far back I can remember my life, and there's specific songs and stuff where I was so small, I can't tell you, like, I was probably 3 or 4 years old, and there's these specific music that would be playing at, like, holiday resorts. And now, I mean, I can't even tell you the names of the songs, but if those songs play right now, I would immediately remember the place we were, more or less what time of the year, who was present, and more importantly, I would get, like, the sense of taste of caramel dip ice cream or something that went with that time that was special. There's like this other song as well, and it's such a not me type song from Wickfield, I think. Didi da 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 or something. Saturday night. I think it's Saturday night. This song was like big stuff on my first
exactly trip what you're talking about. Yeah.
Like my first time ever to Cape Town with my parents and whatever. And I remember we would walk around in the V&A waterfront back then and buy donuts. And I just remember eating donuts with this song playing at that time during December. It was like the number one hit in the world or whatever. And it just like every time you got in the car and you turned on Cape FM, that was the song that was playing. And it's just never, ever going to leave my side. And I mean, there's good connections, there's bad connections. I remember one night my dad and I, we were sitting in the front of the car driving down to the South Coast. And we also did a midnight drive through. So we left our side at like 11 p.m. and we got there at like 6 a.m. in the morning the next day. And during this one part of the road, Celine Dion's Power of Love was playing. Now that's a super, super powerful tune, right? And there was a biker that came past us, and as he went into the curve of the road, he started crashing. Like he started leaning too far on the left, and I just remember the sparks and how he crashed down in the middle of the road, and my dad tried to get over the highway to go and help him, and one of those big Luxliner buses came past and actually picked up the exhaust that was laying in the road and threw it into our car. And it's just crazy, like every single time I hear that song now, that's the only thing I remember. And that's
feels,
one of the...
Feels like you're still there,
Exactly. I mean, that's one of the most powerful, I would say, almost expressions of how powerful music can be, is the fact that it can instantly take you back to specific times and places that it's just like you would never, ever remember it more vividly with any other mechanism than the music that was playing.
Yeah, I mean, I take, for instance, we've spoken about this a bit in the past as well. We were both in the skating, BMXing, punk rock sort of era as well when we were younger. And I mean, I've got a ton of videos and photos and everything of those times. And from time to time, I go through them and stuff, but nothing takes me back as good as your music does, listening to the type of music that I listened to back then. I mean, back then it was Sum 41 and your Blink 182 and Plus 44 and Angels and Airwaves and all these really cool punk bands and stuff that I was listening to. And even now, to this day, I have those things on my playlist on an ongoing basis, because even though that's a very big part of my past, there's no way I can really relive that at all beyond just listening to the music. Yeah, and it really, really takes you back to the good times. It feels like I'm still a little skater boy or skater kid, you know?
Yeah. So,
it's insane how powerful that is, which actually reminds me of something else. I think music has a massive, massive impact on your life in the regard that it does form a big part of your personality and your identity and who you are. Who you associate yourself with as well. I think it goes without saying, because that's how I made a lot of my friends. And I think that's how you connect deeper with a lot of people. It's like, I don't trust people who listen to jazz. Well, not entirely, but I don't. I can't relate. Like maybe we'll be friends on the surface and stuff, but like we'll never have as deep of a connection as I would have with someone like you, for instance. You know, you understand metal, you understand punk rock and rock and all those type of things. And we identify to a deeper level. So
I think it is true what you mean. I think a less harsh way of putting it would be that, generally speaking, if someone else is into dance music and you're into dance music, more than likely you'll already get along.
And that's a better way of putting it, yeah. Maybe I was a little bit too harsh, man. I'm kidding, of course, but yeah.
It's like me and old school country music. I think a lot of people don't understand how much I enjoy my old school country music. And even when I listen to the music and the cheesy lines sometimes, I personally don't understand why I like country music so much. But there's also something very nostalgic in it. But you touched on something interesting in the beginning as well about cognitive performance and so on. I mean, I remember in school, I had some issues with studying sometimes for specific subjects, especially subjects that involved cognitive thinking. So basically stuff like math and science and stuff where you actually have to think and not just reiterate stuff. And I remember at that time, there was my dad listened to, and by the way, my dad's been one of the biggest inspirations of music in my life. I mean, me and him shares almost exactly the same music taste, and that actually spreads very, very wide. As much as I prefer my rock music, I can actually listen to almost anything and really enjoy it. And at the time, he was listening to Enigma and Gregorian and Enya and like all this very, very like classical instrumental type. I wouldn't say it's orchestral, but it's almost like, I don't know, like bohemian type music. And that stuff helped me study, like you won't believe. And then the research actually says the same. It says that if you're going to listen to like upbeat music and stuff, that's not going to be good for studying. That's good for energy. But if you want to actually get good cognitive improvement, like quiet music without much lyrics, orchestral, classical music, not too complex music, really does help. Almost, it should actually just be like background noise. And I think that was my issue, is my brain fires at like 20 cylinders the whole time. So if there's like white noise, but in my case, white noise doesn't work. But if there's like background music, it flushes away like all the other voices in my head and kind of just helps me to focus on the page that I'm on. And that really helped me through a lot of my studying. And it's not that I was a bad academic. I just noticed very early on that I struggled to concentrate while studying. I'll be studying a page and then suddenly see, oh, my pencil needs sharpening, and then sit and sharpen my pencil. And lo and behold, 20 minutes later, I'm still fiddling with my pencil on the edge of a paper, and I'm like, oh, crap, like I missed 30 minutes of studying now. But put on some Enya or something, I'll be laser focused, and I'll get through the materials, and I'll be able to actually function cognitively quite well. So that's
funny that you mentioned, it's really funny that you said that, Leon, because I came across some specific research topic that I was doing, and somewhere along the line, they started talking about music and its involvement in, or its effect that it has on you while studying. And there's an interesting thing that they mentioned. It's the Baroque era type of music. It's a type of classical music in a specific setting back in history, I think the 1600s or something like that. And it's actually proven that by listening to Baroque music, it will really help you concentrate and study. And here's what the research actually says about that, right? It says, since Baroque music generally travels within 50 to 80 beats per minute, it stabilizes mental, physical, and emotional rhythms, which creates a strong mental environment for studying. There's also something about that. So it's not just the fact that it's classical and that it doesn't have any lyrics, because there's some studies that show that you get distracted by the lyrics. And there's only so much...
Yeah, you want to listen to what they say.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Even if you're not consciously aware of it and you try and concentrate on reading something and it's just really soft in the background. I've tested this out myself. I've tried and I've wondered, why is it that I'm not focusing today? It's because I'm listening to a playlist that I know the songs, or maybe I don't know the songs and I want to listen to the lyrics and stuff, even if it's on volume 2, you know? So there's something very powerful of listening to music that doesn't have lyrics, number one. And number two, there's actual science behind and the studies behind the tempo of the songs as well and the style of the songs. So true. Baroque music, man, it's a real thing. There's actual research done around how that
improves.
We
should put that in the show notes. That's a very, very interesting topic in and of itself. Mm. I think if I didn't hear from it from you, that would have been completely new to me as well. And the study behind it is actually very, very interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I'll definitely include some things. There's some really cool places that you can find that. I think we'll include some of the tools or places in the tips section of today's episode. But perhaps let's have a look at some of the other research, Leon, in terms of what an impact music actually has on our lives, perhaps stress-related or anything else more. What do you have for us?
I think the next one was going to be stress relief, right? I think that's probably... If I go back and I think of the first stress I ever had, like I can't tell you when that was or where exactly we started noticing stress pop up in our lives. I don't know if it happens at a certain age. I don't know what triggers it exactly, but I just know that we all live with stress now. We live in a stressful world, and we get stressed by different stresses. Mm-hmm. And there's a ton of research that shows the impact that music has on stress. And you would assume that, obviously, relaxing music. If you walk into like a massage parlor or a spa, day spa, there's always like this tranquil music playing. And absolutely. I walk in there, I immediately feel like I'm escaping reality for a little bit, and I'm walking into a much less stressful environment. And then that bodybuilder Thai lady jumps on me and starts ripping my body apart, and I don't feel that relaxed anymore. But anyways, it's not really necessarily just the type of music. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's just soft music and stuff like that. I take myself for example. When I was younger, and this still works to this day, the harder the better for me when it comes to stress relief, right? Mm-hmm. If I can put on the heaviest hard rock music, pumping music, I just don't know. I completely escape reality for a little bit there. And for me, it's the opposite. As soon as the music is too soft, the reality of my situation can still kind of shine through and still seeps into the moment. Whereas if it's so overwhelmingly brutal and loud and that honestly takes me and transcends me to a completely different world. So as far as stress relief is concerned, I absolutely agree. There's actually a study that was done in 2013 that took three groups. Once again, they always try. It's very difficult to do studies with only two groups because it can obviously result inconclusive. There was a group that listened to relaxing music. Others listened to sound of just rippling water. And then there's another group that received no auditory stimulation. And then they introduced various different types of stress responses to the groups. And it was completely conclusive. The group that received music had the best reaction, and they measured this with within your nervous system, actually. So they actually looked at the impulses on your brain with those brain reading systems. And actually, the people that listened to relaxing music, they had the biggest stress relief. The rippling water had an effect as well on the ANS, or the autonomic nervous system, whilst the people with no stimuli as far as music is concerned actually dealt with stress as usual. They didn't actually see any improvement. So there's obviously, and I mean, I don't think the studies need to tell us more. I think we've all experienced it. Every time you get into a very stressful situation, there's a lot of things that you can do that can help. Music's just one of those. Music is one of those things that just kind of takes you out of your situation, allows you to focus on something energetic or something joyful or whatever the case might be. So, yeah, I don't know. For you, do you use stress or music in stressful situations as well?
I do, Leon. I think there's a couple of things that I want to actually touch on that you mentioned there. One of them being this, the research study is actually quite interesting, because I remember when I was younger, my mom was very, very highly focused on getting us to perform optimally when we were studying or concentrating, or especially studying. And she actually bought this whole package thing. I can't remember if it was in Globe Mail or Verymark or one of those online, or I mean, TV ad sort of sale things, where they also had a bunch of discs included with, yeah, those infomercials, where they also had a bunch of discs included that, you know, either plays classical music or waves crashing or something like that. And I still don't know if that makes a difference, but it is interesting to know that the type of sounds that you're absorbing, you know, be it music or sound effects, there is one that actually is has proven more successful. So very, very interesting, especially now that that actually ties into the Baroque music that we mentioned earlier on. So actually really, really interesting seeing or hearing that. The other thing is that you touched on your stress relief, and that's exactly it for me. I think in some cases, yes, if you're feeling a little bit anxious or you want to concentrate or something, hearing the sort of quiet elevator music or classical music and stuff, that does calm you down or reduces anxiety, I think, for me. But I do understand what you meant with the louder it is, the heavier it is, the more relaxed you feel. It's basically like the way I picture it is, imagine you tell your wife to calm down while she's already flipping out, you know, you can, like, you're just adding fuel to the fire. And that's sort of like how it feels at times. If I'm extremely raged up, then I can't, don't come and play me some classical stuff, man. Like, give me the heavy stuff. No, Let me work through that. And actually, it reminded me of, you know, how misinterpreted these type of genres could be as well. Because when I was younger, you know, being a dramatic little teenager boy, going through puberty, dealing with, you know, the whole world falling apart and my life falling apart and nothing else works out and all those things, right? Like those extremely strong emotions you deal with when you're going through your teenage years. I started listening to heavy metal, and instantly I was judged by that. I think a lot of people are. They instantly associate you with like the gothic or the emo kids, or I don't know, dark arts or witchcraft kind of groups and stuff as well. And it's not
the amounts of time I've heard older people tell me it's satanic.
Satanic, yeah, exactly. Hey? There's so many negative things associated with heavy metal and stuff. And I think if I really had to go and break it down for people out there, if you don't understand why people listen to heavy metal, this is it. Okay, this is the gospel right here. Heavy metal is a real good diffuser, and that's how it really impacted my life. I think it has played such a massive, massive role, because you not only form this you know, great bond of belonging amongst other people who are like-minded, who listen to the same type of metal music or hang out in those type of groups, as much as, yes, you do get a bunch of negative stuff that happens, and just by some weird coincidence, there is some heavy metal playing in the background. But heavy metal is a massive, massive diffuser. And I think there's this massive misinterpretation of how heavy metal is negative. but it really is positive for me, at least I know in my experience. If I go through an extremely upsetting or tough time, and I'm so frustrated, you listen to the heavy metal music and it almost feels like you're releasing all of that energy out in this music so that you don't rage out, or so that you don't have to throw something against the wall or do something rash or flip out on someone. It really does calm me down in that sense. I think that's just something to point out. I don't know, Leon, have you had the same experience with heavy metal
like
as well?
110%. I think it's probably the most stereotyped and judged music genre out there is metal and heavy metal, or even hard rock and roll. And it's 100% the music that I enjoy the most. And I think the reason I enjoy it is because you're quite right. It's something that I think we identify with a little bit, because more than often heavy metal band players and so on are themselves a little bit outcast. And they sing about many times about heartfelt sadness in their lives or things that happened in their life and how they triumphantly come out the other side. And things like that. I mean, the misinterpretation is almost, it's almost as if heavy metal is a slap in the face of people that create stereotypes. Mm-hmm. It's to kind of show them that, listen, go and read the lyrics and you'll actually find the exact opposite of what you thought. I mean, I just out of interest, I found a few lyrics that are from songs that are so commonly misinterpreted. And I think, you know, if you think about the amount of time you've heard older people maybe say Ozzy Osbourne is satanic, or Slipknot, or whatever the case might be, like all these bands are so bad and so dark and so evil and so on. I mean, there could be truth in certain ones, but generally stereotyping is what's not correct. So there's one song, for example, from Ozzy Osbourne called Suicide Solution. Now, it's one of those songs where immediately certain group of people would immediately say, yeah, see, that song is probably about suicide and how suicide is the best way to get rid of life and all this stuff. But meantime, the guy's actually singing about how bad drinking habits are and how drinking and being an alcoholic is a very slow suicide. Like, that's just a slow way to kill yourself and you should stop doing that. And this is Mr. Ozzy Osbourne. Probably everyone listening at least knows who I'm talking about. And he definitely does not have a reputation amongst many people as someone that would say something like stop drinking because it's a slow suicide. But that is what his music is saying. And that might just inspire one alcoholic kid that's going down the road of alcoholism to realize, listen, if this legend of a rock god, Mr. Ozzy Osbourne himself, is saying that, because look at him, right? Look what drugs did to him. And he's saying that it's a slow suicide and a slow burn to go and drink your life away. Maybe he saved a couple of lives through just those few lyrics. And that's just one example in a pool of examples and in an ocean of examples of music that come off as itchy, scratchy, heavy metal music, stereotyped by massive amounts of people. But when you go and dig deep into the meaning of the music, it's usually much deeper than most people would expect.
I think that's interesting, because on the opposite side of the coin as well, most people, and my parents included, tried to keep me away from all of the negative music in the world and constantly asked me, they didn't try and keep me away from it, but constantly warned me of, don't listen to this type of music because it's going to affect you negatively. But I think so many people look past the fact that, have you listened to the lyrics of the pop songs nowadays, right? Have you actually listened to the lyrics?
True.
I think that's actually worse than your, go and restrict your kids from listening to the radio rather than restricting them from listening to alternative music and stuff, because some of that stuff is just so vulgar, man. Like, I don't know. And
very,
I think
raunchy,
it's, yeah. And I think it's extremely important to take note of that type of stuff. As little control as we could actually get over that, I think it, you know, where we can, we should try and apply that to our lives, to the lives of our kids as well. I'm not a parent, but here's what I'm saying, is that music can alter your mood. You know, science has proven this, and research and studies and all those things, and we know this, right? It can alter your mood, and in a very, very deep level. because it's not only alters your mood, but it speaks to you subconsciously. Whether you listen to the lyrics consciously and you absorb that information, either way, it is entering your system. And the subconscious mind, this is something that I still want to talk about in a future episode, though, is it's been proven in studies that the subconscious mind has 95% control over your actions on a daily basis.
This is true.
Where the conscious mind only has 5% control over your actions in a specific, in a particular day. This has been proven by studies and stuff, right? 95% of it happens subconsciously. So by making sure that you're absorbing, you know, good music and positive music the and right all those stuff and the right stuff, just the right stuff. It doesn't always have to be positive and stuff, but, you know, go and have a look and don't judge heavy metal or any of those other type of, you know, heavier or punk rock or type of alternative music scenes or genres with too much intent, because at the end of the day, there's a lot of other ones that are also commonly misinterpreted, or we're looking past them.
100%. I mean, the one aspect here is that at the end of the day, this should serve as entertainment, right? So if you get entertained by pop music, you get entertained by pop music. I personally listen to popular music, but I find that it doesn't live as long as, for example, rock and roll music. For example, a brand new tune from one of the great top 20 artists in the world right now, I would be jamming to it as well. But I probably find that after one night of a party playing that song twice or thrice or whatever, I would be over that song. But that's just me. We're here to say that all music is great in its own right, but it is very important. And one of the topics that we did want to touch on is to not put music into certain boxes and not put them into certain stereotypes. I've listened to some really strange music as well that is not even in any, I don't even really know what class to put it in. But it's got certain impacts in your life, and that, and it invokes certain moods, and it brings about certain feeling inside of you, and that's actually the effect that you want from music. Just listening to music, like pop music, I find is like popcorn. You know, it's something that satisfied the immediate thrill, and that's fine. It's got its space, right? I'm not going to go listen to a Taylor Swift or a Justin Bieber song because I want to get soul food out of it. Like, I want to make life changes or something.
Well, Taylor Swift, to that though. Well, Taylor Swift, I'm going to object there, dude. I'm a big Tay Tay fan.
It's an example. It's an example.
Maybe not her recent stuff, but her original stuff.
She's a very good writer. I know.
Yeah. Don't mess with my Tay Tay, man.
I forgot. I stepped on. I think I lost half of our audience now. Well, I hope we don't have too many Tay Tay listeners. no, but just what I'm trying to say is that the music that you listen to affects your social life as well. You'll inevitably have friends that listen to similar music. You'll make those relationships and, you know, create those memories for life with and around that type of music, whether that's pop music, whether that's rock music, whether that's dance, house, hip-hop, classical, blues, it doesn't matter. I kind of listen to a little bit of everything at some stage. It's crazy for me how much hate there can be between two different music group listeners. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in South Africa, we've got Afrikaans music. You know, we've got Sokki music as well, which is like our pop music. And there's a ton of people that listen to that stuff. And then guys would go and say, yeah, but I don't ever listen to that because it's not cool. But then you go to the first barbecue with them and you join them for a party. That's the first music they put on and everyone's enjoying it, right? So it just goes to show, like, music brings out mood, it brings out friendship, it brings out joy. But on a very intimate level, it can also improve learning, improve your mood, help with cognitive thinking, help with your emotional state, depression. There's a lot of other stuff. Like, music is actually very, very powerful in many different ways.
Yeah, I agree with that. Leon, I think it's really cool that you mentioned that, though, because I remember back when I was younger, and I'm not sure if this is a thing that just comes with, you know, as you mature through life and all that, but a lot of my so-called friends or groups that I was associated with and stuff really had this fence built around what the group of people should be listening to. I'm referring to high school and stuff, you know. There's always this whole thing of, like, No, but you're part of this group. You don't listen to heavy metal music. Or no, you're part of this group and you only listen to heavy metal music and stuff like that. And I've seen this sort of leap into adult years and stuff as well, where some people are very judgmental when it comes to people liking a certain genre or a certain type of music and stuff as well. So I think it is important to be open-minded and don't... music is a very... a personal thing, I think, for me at least. It always has been. I think be very open-minded towards that and just understand that people have their own different tastes as well. So always take that into consideration, because it will affect your social interactions with people around you as well, whether that being positive or negative as well. Something to just take into consideration is be mindful that a person might like a specific song because it might take them back to a specific incident that occurred in their life, and they like revisiting that, or they like remembering that specific memory and dating back to that as well. So those are the things that I think we should take into consideration. Leon, I think it's also time for the real life for today. So let me start you off. What tips do you want to share with us today?
Yes, I think if we didn't mention this enough already, I think the first thing is to break out of stereotype. So if you don't listen to orchestral music because maybe you see it as the background music in Lion King, or maybe you see it as you're not smart enough to understand the music, go get yourself a really, really good headset. Right, this is the first thing you need to have. You need to have good speakers or systems that you listen orchestral music especially to, because you need to be able to listen to the different sound separation and things like that, and the stage and so on. But when you start listening to orchestral music in very, very high definition and good quality, and you can start hearing the separate instruments, and this is just an example, I'm not saying everyone hears a Joe, go and listen to opera music and stuff like that, but you then start at least appreciating the depth and the quality and the technique and the talent that goes into making that very, very complex music. Same goes for, as we just said, hard rock. Stop hating on the hard rock people so much and saying that it's all satanic music. Go listen to the lyrics. Listen to the rhythm. I promise you there's a rock music in everyone's closet that they love. And this the rest of the genre doesn't fall too far from the rock music that you, for example, like. I mean, my father-in-law probably listens to the most relaxed music in the world. And when I met him, one of the first songs he's played on his guitar for me was Nothing Else Matters from Metallica. When I told him it's Metallica, he almost fell off his chair. I was like, yeah, no, that's Metallica. That's the guy that apparently, is a Satan worshiper, So stop stereotyping and classifying music into certain classes. I think all music has a certain place and a certain style to everyone. And the fact that we actually judge people based on the taste of their music is probably a little bit immature and maybe out of place. And the challenge I would put with this is, like I said, go and try a different type or style of music this week. But give it a good shot, like give it a real, real good try. If there's certain types of music that you've always thought, yeah, I want to give that a go, like I want to give that a try. Like, anyway, I watched an animation movie about jazz music the other day, and that just got me into jazz music. And I promise you, if you listen to it in that frame of mind, the whole genre just opened up to me and I started appreciating jazz music.
I love that. I think it's quite interesting, Liam, because that actually reminds me, I recently started listening to more Spanish music. I've always loved Spanish music, but for some odd reason, more recently, I just started listening to more of that. So a few things that you mentioned in there. So basically break out of the stereotypes and listen to the lyrics and try a different type of music. I really dig that. I think from my point of view, I also might have a few, maybe one, two or three. The first thing I would give as a tip here is, if you're focusing on maybe studying something at the moment, or maybe you're doing some part of your job involves extreme concentration, go and listen to some Baroque music. I'll try and link a playlist on YouTube.
You might want to spell that out for us, it sounds like broke music. Broken music.
Yeah. I'll list it out in the show notes if you're interested. I'll try and add in a YouTube playlist or something. There is one specific one where they play it live 24/7, I think. If you could just switch that up on maybe YouTube Music or on YouTube itself, doesn't really matter. But go and give that a shot. I think that's really, really, that's one of my action steps that I'm going to do straight after our session here today as well, as I'm really going to try and incorporate that into my studying routines and stuff as well. That's tip number one. Tip number two that I have is try using music more in your relationships. Okay, this is something that I've incorporated in my relationship for, well, since the beginning of it. No, that's not exactly what I mean. What I mean is that, remember that we spoke of the fact that music really can, you know, spur on this nostalgia and take you back in time, and really, really, it's like a time capsule. So if you've been in a relationship for an extremely long time and, you know, maybe there's that one specific special song that you guys heard when you first kissed, or when you guys first went on a walk in the park and it came up somewhere at a nearby restaurant or something that takes you back on that. I think music is a massive, massive big part of my relationship for a couple of reasons. Because we've got a lot in common in the sense of our music types and styles and, you know, things that we enjoy in music. And also, you know, at the same time, there's a lot of nostalgia tied around it. Like, we talk about the good old days, even when we weren't together, you know, when we were kids and this song came up. And yeah, it really, really does just provide a very deep connection in a relationship as well. So really using that to grow your own relationship, I think, is one of my top tips that I want to leave with the audience here today. The other one, last one, and this is something that I've also done quite a bit in the past, is build yourself a good playlist. Whether it's a playlist to wake up to some really, really cool tunes that just cheers you up, right? But build it as you go along. If you discover new songs, add new songs to that playlist. Because what I do some days, if I struggle getting out of bed and I'm not feeling this day, I put on it's the first thing that I do in the morning when I wake up on those days, is I put on my music so that I can wake up, get dressed and all those things, but to the good vibes. And that alters the mood that I go into that day with. So whether it is for you to wake up, or maybe just push you through that last bit of the week, so create a midweek playlist or something just to push you through to the end of the week, just so that you can enjoy the weekend again if it's a tough week. Or even an exercise playlist. Find the best tunes that really, really just gives you a lot of energy that you can exercise to. I think that really, really does help you achieve your fitness goals in that regard as well. So those are my three tips. Very nice. Leanne, what do you think?
No, I've got just one last one. And this is not necessarily with every single song out there, but especially with music that maybe you're not relating to, or if you are one of those that think about hard rock in the wrong way, or that it's dark or whatever, give the lyrics a listen. Sometimes you'll be quite surprised at what sits behind the lyrics. And many times, if you Google the lyrics, you might actually get explanation about the backstory around that song, or why that song was written in that specific way, etc. And that will open your eyes up to maybe a completely different view of that particular song. But yeah, that goes without saying. Go listen to the lyrics. I'm not saying for pop music, to be honest. Those lyrics are usually quite hollow. I'm talking about the more, I would say, frowned upon styles, not just hard rock, maybe other styles as well. I mean, when I listened to my first bit of hip hop back in the days with Eminem, and it's very, very hardcore lyrics, but it's actually extremely good, right? I mean, if you do listen about the pain and the hurt in all of the lyrics that he sings, that's probably 50% what got me into listening to his music, was just the fact that his lyrics were really, really, really good quality. So yeah, that would be the other one. If it's a style that you don't like, give the lyrics a listen. It might open your mind up.
I love that.
That's it. That's it from my side. I mean, this was a topic I've wanted to do for a very, very long time. I think a lot of people out there are also music enthusiasts and connoisseurs even. For those, we probably didn't bring anything delightful today. But for those that just wanted to have a happy-go-lucky talk around music and the impact that it has on our lives, I thank you. I thank you for being here.
There you have it. Remember to head over to rltstudios.com/show24. We're running a poll to find out if you want more. It's going to take you 2 seconds, two little questions. Head over to rltstudios.com/show24. Give us your feedback. We really, really want that. And again, thank you all so much for joining this episode. We look forward to seeing you guys on the next one. Until then, my name's Mono.
I'm Leon. Thank you very much. We'll see you guys on the next episode. Cheers.
Bye.